someone please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Auggie Smith to the big Podathon for Andy. Okay,
what's going on, boys? I gotta be honest, I can hardly hear you. I should have had some headphones ready. So can you talk amongst yourselves for a second? Let me get some headphones.
Oh, sure. Yes, or we could just yell.
I'm just going to assume you're saying yeah. I'm just going to assume. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah. Give me 1 second. Enjoy my backyard while all this is happening.
Oh, your backyard. Let's see this.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, I see a dildo. That's not right. My backyard has a bunch of homeless guys frozen to death in it right now.
Yeah, your backyard looks like a gay serial killer's fucking backyard. This guy's got.
Are
like
we talking about my bidet backyard, or are you talking about my the back of
the bidet house? The bidet backyard? Of course, okay. It's unprecedented.
Well, it works, but now your camera's out. Oh,
one or the other. I could shut the door.
What the hell's going on here?
Everyone's leaving and making weird excuses.
I think we've lost control here, Carl. Oh, now your light's going on, Jamie.
My penis fell off. I had to go get my penis.
This is the most bizarre thing ever. First of all, Carl, is there somebody in your house? Because a light just went onto the side of you that you didn't seem to control, and that seems like ghostly.
Jesus, don't fucking say that to me. Don't say that to me.
Okay, I can hear. Can you hear me?
We can hear you, but we can't see you anymore. I think you turned your camera.
Why the hell can't you see me?
We're seeing a black. Well, you turn your camera on.
It's saying I'm in the show and everybody can see and hear me. Are you trying to say that Steve Jobs is lying?
Oh, maybe it's not enough.
One of you is lying. Either Apple's lying or you assholes are lying.
I would say
Steve
Apple.
Apple.
They gave that data to the FBI. Fuck Apple.
I turned camera off and I turned camera back on.
Well, leave the room and come back in. Do that.
Okay, I'll leave the room and come back in.
All right, do that.
Good idea.
I'm going to have to do the applause for him all over again when he comes back in.
Do you know what? I thought there was a ghost.
Are you getting sick of the applause and the sound effects?
The light was my monitor turning.
Yeah,
on.
But what about the shadow with the look on it on the wall back there?
Carl, you shit yourself there. You actually looked like you shit yourself. It was hilarious.
Something just happened. I thought it was a joke.
Auggie's back. Shut up!
Auggie's back. When you left, Carl had an experience in the background. The dog saw something like a shadow in Carl's background, and Carl went like, what the fuck was that?
I'm seeing this.
Genuine. I have my genuine.
On the wall really? Back there, I could swear. Auggie, welcome. Thanks for coming. Weird.
Thanks. It makes this more relatable when things like that happen. I'm in my backyard. You're going to hear the neighbor's dog and quite possibly my kids. So that's what's going on here.
Well, where are you?
I'm not cool like you guys. I have to have a life with responsibility.
I'm the same, but I put painkillers in my kids' drinks and they're sleeping. They'll be gone for 12 hours. Night, night.
Ah, great idea. Gosh. Look at this. I'm already picking up parenting tips. I didn't know I was on Dr. Phil. I love it.
Yeah, it's what you got to do. I mean, it's over-the-counter stuff. It ain't illegal. I mean, it does say you got to be over the age of 16, but hey, you know, potato, tomato, you know. As for the dog,
it doesn't say don't make them snort it.
Well, it's true. That is
we
true.
Have a new total, 23,412. So we're up. Somebody just donated $300. Way to go. We're doing well. Keep those cards and letters coming, folks. Auggie, nice. If you haven't heard the news, Andy is out of surgery, doing well, and tweeting stupid shit like a madman.
Yeah.
It's basically his life has not changed so far. It's exactly what it's been. He's laying drugged out, making jokes on Twitter. Thank God for him. Thank God for Andy Andrist. So this is a great story about Andy. I don't know if he's ever told this on any of the various things, but so in his old house, next door, they were going to build an apartment complex, right? And so every once in a while, the greasy guy, and I'm going to get his name wrong, but it was like Doug Rudiger, something like that. And so this greasy guy would come up with the clients, that were going to move into this apartment complex they were going to build, and it was going to be this giant thing next to Andy, and it was going to block his view, and he was upset about it. So, like, where the rest of us would just swallow that or perhaps look for a new house to live in, Andy's solution was he went to a garage sale, and he spent, like, $50 on an old electric guitar and an old amp. And so every time he saw Dave Rudiga pull up with a client, he'd run out to the end of his driveway, turn the amp all the way up, and play this song that he had written called Dave Rudiga Wears Khaki Pants, Khaki Pants, like as loud as he could. He would just sing a cappella with the guitar going to drive people away. Now, did it stop it? No. No, the man's going to come with his machines, and he's going to build his buildings, but there's nothing that says you can't have something to say about it.
Yeah. Well, nowadays that would go viral, and the guy would get out his phone and say, look at this fucking maniac neighbor.
Yeah, and then Andy could finally sell some tickets. Yeah.
It would be probably the most marketable thing he's ever done.
Hilarious. That's fucking class. How long ago was this? Was this like a couple of years back or just like...
This is probably 15 years ago when he lived in his old house. Every time I drive down to Southern Oregon, I was in Portland, he was in Eugene. I'd stop at his place. We'd go hide in his greenhouse and get high in his greenhouse and talk about life. Here's the thing about Andy. This is one of the great things about Andy Andrist. It's not just how funny he is. I believe this about Andy is that he makes other people funnier. He is a muse to other people's best funny self. I am at my best around him, and I know that of pretty much everyone I know. We're all at our funniest around him.
Right. He's taken I'm not going to give him 100% credit for this, but Chad Shank was never an entertainer in his life, but he shines as a comedian with world-class comedians on a podcast, and you would think he was a comedian by just the stuff he contributes to that show. That's a testament to Andy's bringing out the funniest in everybody. I agree with that.
Damn right.
He is a muse, isn't he? He's just fucking, he is what he is. He's, in theory, in the whole spectrum of reality, Andy Andrist should not work as a comedian, but he's just fucking, he's phenomenal. He's perfect. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
He is fucking
It's so many things about him. So the secret to Andy, first of all, his delivery. His delivery sounds like a guy mumbling that stuff to himself. His delivery sounds like he's just walking the streets in a hospital gown, perhaps, and having these thoughts in his head. And nobody else delivers that way. I mean, it's a completely original the way that he delivers a joke. I was gonna tape an hour in Portland, this like 4 or 5 years ago, at this theater that has these government loans, so they just have in the place a 3-camera shoot that you just get that. So I was all excited about it and promoted it, and Andy was going to come up and do some time beforehand, and Andy was working on some stuff, so that's what he decided to talk about. And it was about cops having freeways named after them and after they get killed in duty, and then he was making fun of that and talking about how it's like you don't get to retire the jersey after you're done, man. Not knowing that I have a high school friend that's a cop in Vancouver, Washington, and he had brought quite a few people that night, just setting the worst mood, just the worst possible atmosphere for me entering stage. And even though it was the worst possible opening act I could have, it was still hilarious. I'm still happy that I got to see it, even though it wrecked this thing for me. That's the beauty of Andy Andrist.
Yeah.
Is that I would rather that he wrecked it and then I got to see that too.
He's a really special kind of guy, which is why this is, and I don't want to get all heavy here, but I think this is really important. People don't understand the value that this one man brings to so many people, and that so many people love him so much beyond just being fans of his comedy, just the fans of the man's spirit and who he is and everything he stands for and everything he represents to all of us. It's really astonishing to me to see that embodied in one person. It really is. I mean,
yeah, what you were saying, Auggie, about him being like a man who's mumbling to himself. I never ever articulated that, but now I do. Now I realize that's one of the reasons why I love him talking, because it's almost, I guess it resonates with us all mumbling to ourselves.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And Auggie, that observation alone reminded me of like Carlin's way of taking, without doing it, like taking, sitting down and at doing a conscious analyzing of somebody's comedy, that you just get what makes him special just from, is that something you do a lot of with other comedians? Because it seemed like very Carlin-esque to kind of be able to just pull that very accurate description of why, what is so lovable about his delivery.
Well, I've been around this a long time. I've been around it for 30 years. And so, yeah, there was a time when I was very much just in the creation and doing of it. And as the years went by, I really enjoyed the studying of it and what specifically made things funny, just in watching the way different people did it. And with Andy, his punchlines, A, are so subtle. It's such a subtlety when he moves in to the end of the bit. He doesn't have a need to hit you over the head with it, and he'll give you a second. That's the other thing. So many comics talk over their punchlines. Andy gives you a second because he knows that it takes a second half the time. And he's much more of a tactician as a comic than he gets credit for. He's more of a tactician than he gets credit for, because that kind of energy that he brings it's a very difficult thing to pull people into, but he just does that right away. Yeah, man. No, I mean,
as a
comic, it's easy to love him, and it's easy to show why you love him as a comic. And the other thing is, as a man, you just can't have a better friend than Andy Andrist. Andy Andrist is an aggressive friend. Andy and I would not be friends if he was not aggressive in getting a hold of me, because I'm one of those people. I meet you, we have a great time. But I think, man, it's weird to call this person or text them. I feel like, you know, just the beginnings of a friendship are so uncomfortable for me that I don't approach them. And the only friends that I have are aggressive. And Andy is just an aggressively good friend that way. And as a dad, he's raised just a delightful young woman. And so I just, he's a good person along with being, but he's also a drug-addled mess. He's all those things. He embodies what we as artists hope to be. So yeah, anyway, enough about Andy. What's going on in my life, guys?
Yeah, what is going on in your life?
What are you doing, brother?
Yeah, tell us what really is. What are you doing? Because this is a challenging time for everybody in the entertainment industry still, 2 years in.
Brett Erickson just plugged his own date, so if you want to do that, I don't know.
Did he do a merch pitch? Is there a website we can go to and buy some Brett Erickson?
He's selling Andy Andrist's fucking tumor as merch. Yeah, that's what he's doing.
I guess while we're at it, let me quickly do this. If I can't really do it quickly because StreamYard's being slow now. But speaking of Brett Erickson, I did want to bring this up really quickly, and I can't do it really quickly. I should be more prepared with this shit. Anyway, the bidet. It's $10 the bid on the bidet right now. I'm not seeing it in here. Chrome tab.
Do you use a bidet at all?
I never have, and people, they just rave about them. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with them. I've never had bidet money. I mean, I understand these people that have bidet money. I just don't have it.
Carl,
well, $10 is a going bid on the
The first people I spoke to have never used a bidet, and you and me, brother, what we should do is hook up hotel room in a non-gay way and just get a bidet hotel room and just blast our asses with a bidet, say we've used a bidet.
A bidet.
I've stayed in rooms that have had them, and I've just never used them. I don't know. I don't know if it's gay panic, whatever it is. I get weird when anything approaches my ass.
Yeah,
I sometimes I think I might have those forgotten, you know, like I've pushed out that something bad happened to me, Because, yeah, I mean, I was like a chubby kid that was an altar boy, and I was real lonely.
Easy to
and
catch.
My mom would, like, you know, I'd stay with strangers all the time. So it probably happened. But here's, I don't want to recover that shit. I don't want to be reminded of that.
It probably happened.
And what if the bidet brings that back? What if that's the trigger? Like, no, as soon as the bidet hits me, I remember that time at St. Patrick's Cathedral with Father Dwyer. I don't want to think about that.
That's
but it. What if it did bring it back and you went to find him and say, do it again?
Yeah, exactly.
It could go either
what
way.
What if I like it? What if I like it too much?
Exactly.
What if I was the one that initiated
it when I was a kid? Right. It wasn't even the father.
Well,
what
you was
you felt trapped.
It was what you were wearing. Yeah. Exactly. But the Vekin Ultra Slim Bidet Non-Electric Dual Nozzle Feminine Posterior Wash is up for bid. It's a $31 value. The highest bid so far is $10. You can bid on it today. The bidding ends at 10 p.m. tomorrow if you want to win get the bidet. All it takes $11 to get your bidet. Get your ass washed.
All right. I'll get it on it.
All right.
Get your bidet today.
How do I bid? Where do I go?
Oh, you just go into any of chat room of wherever this is and just say, yeah, I'm on it.
All right. Somebody is watching. Put me down for 11.
All right. $11. So
11 grand. Fuck me.
And the tote board is still rising. 23, 472. Not bad.
So, okay. Solven has $20 on the bidet.
Yeah. Cool. Well, but seriously, where are you working, man?
All right. So, we had a third kid during pandemic. Now I know I have three kids. And so the thing about it is you look at me and you're like, oh, the kids, they must be like old and like through college or whatever. These are little kids. I have three little kids in my house. So what it's done to my road schedule, along with the fact that most of the clubs I worked have closed. So the two things are, most of the clubs that were closed and having the third kid, I go out usually one or two weekends a month these days.
Wow.
Where am I going to be? Next, I'm in the Pacific Northwest. It's a bunch of different theater gigs in February. That's big road gig I have.
Tell me, because I'm intrigued, because, you know, having kids early in life and now being older, it would seem a nightmare to be middle-aged.
Yeah.
And having it babies. Is.
That's exactly what it is. That's exactly what it is.
Terrific.
Here's two real things that have happened. The day I brought my baby home, my AARP card showed up in the mail. That's a real thing that happened. And that that's a bad sign from any god. it should be retiring. And then another thing is that I literally threw my back out picking up my baby. That's a real thing that happened where I had to like lay on a couch on pills for 6 days from picking up my baby.
Yeah,
so won't be doing that again, I guess. And that's
married a very young. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'm gonna be 69, I think, when this child gets out of high school. I mean, come on, man. What? Then we'll start the second half of our life.
Yeah.
Couple of years tops.
Yeah. So is your bride much younger than you? Yes or no? Because she's still having babies, obviously. She's got to be much younger. No?
Yeah. Yeah. Thank God. Thank God somebody around here is ambulatory. Yeah. I did good. That's the thing is that if you're funny, that you get that. You get a young, hot wife. That's what you get.
Auggie, I'm going to say this. It might be words of wisdom. It might be sacrilege. I don't know. But in the UK, especially in my area where I live, a lot of people, I'm not comparing your baby to a dog, but what I'm saying is this. A lot of people brought dogs during the pandemic, okay? And now the world is open back up. People are going back to work, so therefore they're giving these dogs back to like the pound or whatever. All I'm saying is, you get what I'm saying. You know where I'm going. I'm just...
You're asking if that kid's going to end up at a fire station. I hear you. I hear where you're going with this one.
I'm not.
If we're
just
going to send it back, as it will. No, I'm in for the duration, man. I'm in for the duration of this one.
Just sleep on it.
It's a scary thought. You know, the girl in my band, I probably shouldn't be saying this, but she just had another baby. She's 28 years old, but the guy she's with is my age. And to me, that's like, that guy is going to be, you said 69, this guy's going to be in his mid 70s when the kid graduates high school. So,
dead.
Yeah, can you imagine?
Well, that one is like, is meeting the parents just must have been a nightmare. Like, yeah. What an awkward dinner that was. Yeah. When they probably were in high school together, or if that guy could have been older than the parents. Yeah. Good God, my wife is 10 years younger, which I think is perfect.
You know what? I think he is older than the parents because I know her dad. He's I think he is.
Yeah.
Wow.
I never thought of that. Yeah, he can walk. If he's older than the parents, he can walk in with his girlfriend to the in-laws and say, "You can't see these people. They're far too old for you, sweetheart. Let's go."
Yeah. Well, I would share more about that offline. It's a fascinating story behind that, but I'm already said too much. Yeah, but comedy life now, you mentioned that, you know, if you're funny, not necessarily the case. I find it can be, you know, girls are attracted to humor, of course, but I find a lot of guys get into comedy because they're just not doing well with women, and it's part of the broken psyche. No, am I wrong about that?
Yeah, don't you think it's odd that it's this job where you have to connect with large groups of people in a short period of time, using only your words and your energy. But yet we're some of the most antisocial people that exist. We are so uncomfortable being around people. I literally had a gig one time where it was at a country club, and they called me and they hadn't sold very many tickets, and I wasn't on a door deal or anything. It was a flat rate. And so they said, so what we thought we would do is we just have like a big dinner with the people and you could just be funny at the table. And I just, no, that's not what I do. That's the opposite of what I do. What you're describing sounds awful. Without the protection of some sort of microphone or stage, and it's just having to be another human being with somebody, awful stuff. Yeah. So people do get into this job, I think, maybe because they have an easier time connecting with anonymous people than they do with actual people that are bringing energy and stuff back to them. I think that is part of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
But now LA comedy, these kids are good looking. They're good looking. And a lot of them don't even come up from messed up backgrounds. They come from fine backgrounds and they're good looking. And it's like, why did you have to develop a defense mechanism in the first place? What's even going on here?
Yeah.
So yeah, there's a whole new generation that I think are very actually good with girls.
Yeah, that's a good question. Like, because I always wonder when I see somebody who's really funny, there's got to be something broken in order for you to be really funny in some way. You have to have some part of your spirit that's been really damaged in order to get funny. But for some people, you can't imagine what it is. You look at them and say, well, this person got it all going on for him. What the fuck could have caused them?
Some people are soft, though. The smallest thing goes wrong, and it just messes with them. I was watching some reality show, and this woman was going off when she was 20. She had body dysmorphia, you know, where you think you look worse than you actually do.
Yeah.
You know, like everybody we've all ever met ever. And this was like a defining thing in this person's life. Like that's what it is. That's the pain you're hanging on to. Come on, man.
Yeah, I get it. Like that's blowing up unnecessary trauma, because I think every single person has that kind of self-doubt, and that's body image problems, right? It's
the rest of us have to get fingered round by the bins in the comedy.
Yeah.
Are you okay, Carl?
I'm spacing out a bit, but I'm doing all right.
Yeah, your eyes are starting.
How long you guys been at this?
Well, since 9 a.m. Eastern, but these guys are both in the UK, so they're 5 hours ahead of me. It's about, what is it, 2:30 in the morning there?
2:30. 2:30,
12 and a half hours.
But they're free to take a break anytime they want. It's just that they
every
are compelled
guest
by
it. Come on, it's been too good to take a break for. So yeah, it's not going to happen.
That's the thing. Exactly what Carl says. Like, oh, we're going to take a break now. And then you pop on. And it's like every time we see someone like tech difficulties, like this guy's going to be great. And it's like, you're there. You're it's like, okay, we're going to stay.
And well, I got news for you. I think it's going to continue because next after Auggie comes Brendan Walsh. Henry Phillips just got in contact with me. And there was a time mix up. But
it's like Panamint.
He will probably be
back at Panamint 2007, baby. Yeah.
See, so you're familiar with James Inman. Were you there for that piss drinking thing? The king of the party.
So I started in Portland, and Inman was in Seattle at the time, right? And I'm not kidding you guys. You think I'm making this up? For 2 years, I thought Inman was a character created by the Seattle comics to tell stories about. I had never met him. I had just heard all these stories about him, and I thought that was like a running gag. Of where you would make some, or you'd hear a crazy story, and you're like, oh, that's Inman. Inman did that. And this is one of the stories I heard about him, was, so he decides he's got to get a straight job, right? So he puts on his, you know, short sleeve collared shirt with tie. He did that look. He puts on a short sleeve collared shirt with tie and his business pants, and he's walking to the interview, and he realizes he's a little bit early, so he stops at a Burger King. And then he goes into the Burger King to use the toilet, okay? Now, it had been raining in Seattle a lot, and Burger King, this particular one, is like a little bit lower than the street, is the best way to describe it. And this, what I'm about to describe to you, happens because I've seen this happen. Sometimes in Seattle, in old buildings, when it rains a lot, the pipes back up. They just completely back up, and they reverse themselves. So Inman gets up from pooping, right, fixes himself, and he hears this, and a kind of a sucking sound, and then all of a sudden the toilet just starts spraying into the stall where Inman is, and he freaks out, and he tries to open the door, and the latch bends, so he's literally stuck in this stall with just stuff spraying out of a toilet. And then it stops for a second, and he's standing there, he's like, and then he hears the sound again, the, and he knows it's about to hit, and he's like, ball it up, and then just, so it happens again, and he finally gets through the door, or goes under, or whatever he does, and he's covered in raw sewage, and he's on his way out of the Burger King, but he's mad and he wants to tell him, you know. And I don't, have you ever seen Inman mad? He hops. He like sort of vibrates up and down, right? And he's hopping. But there's it's morning rush. So he's gotta stand in line for people to complain. Excuse me, your toilet is shooting shit out.
Yeah, I'll have a coffee.
So I heard that and like three other similar stories. And I thought, well, there's no way this is a human being. And then one day I was on a show with him, and oh my God, he's an actual real person that lives up to the hype, that lives up to all the hype I had for what kind of guy he was.
Yeah.
Oh, but this is true about Panamint. I met my wife there. My wife now of 10 years, and that has brought me three children. I met in the desert with the Stanhope crew.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a story to tell the grandchildren.
we're a Stanhope love story. I like to think of it. And that's something, I mean, that's a crowd that, like, once again, this is a great part of Andy's aggressive friendship, is that he's the one that talked me into going. I wouldn't have done that on my own. But he's the one that talked me into going. And,
He's
and now
a bad influence.
My whole life is different because of it.
Yep. Your parents said, Auggie, we don't want you hanging out with that boy. He's a very bad influence on you.
He's no good. No good, I tell you.
Yeah. It looks like Brendan's pulling a time zone mishap, too. I guess. I don't know. It's
only a minute late.
Yeah.
Well, with me, I got to tell you, I knew it was happening. I was just running behind.
Oh, well, I didn't even think you were late, actually. But
ISIS.
Yeah. It's the Inman CIA. Terrorist.
They're coming.
They are coming for you. Definitely Inman informed on you somehow, some way. We have a new total at 23,602. Oh, Everett C. Coop is now with us. Brendan Walsh couldn't make it, obviously. Did you guys book this? Everett C. Coop, the former Surgeon General of the United States of America, is, I think that's who I'm talking about. Anyway, let's get him on. Dr. Coop, welcome.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going. That's all that matters. We're still going. Thank you for coming. What did you do with Brendan Walsh?
I'm not doing a character. It just made me type a name into the thing, and that's why. I just thought it'd be funny. I was in kind of a bad mood.
Well, I just assumed you were doing a character.
I love Mind Dog. I love you. I love having the dog be the best friend of my mind.